Feasting and enjoying food was an important part of medieval life because there wasn't very much to eat during a war. Nobles had to pay for food and wages for their household. The bread was the basic food in the Middle Ages. It could be made with barley, rye, and wheat. Wealthy people used thick slices of brown bread as bowls called trenchers to soak up juice and sauce from the food. Flour made for the castle was ground at the Lord's Mill by his miller. Millers produced different kinds of flour, fine, to make white bread for the king or lord, and brown bread for the servants. Birds like chickens, geese, and ducks were kept. On special occasions, the wealthy ate swan and peacocks. Beef and venison were well liked, and so was pork. Mustard was a favorite ingredient. Medieval people liked to fish and fresh meat that was not salted yet. The meat was salted in huge wooden vats so that the food would not spoil. Salt was expensive, but large quantities were bought every year. Most people ate with their fingers and their knives. Forks were introduced towards the end of the Middle Ages. Many people thought forks were silly, but everyone had to behave properly at mealtime. There were many rules on the correct way to eat and where people sat at the table. Before 1100, honey was the only way to sweeten food because spices were expensive because they came from the Far East. Herbs were used to season food and make remedies for the ill. Crusaders brought new foods like raisins, dates, and figs to Europe. Cereals remained the most important staples during the early Middle Ages, as rice was a late introduction to Europe and the potato was only introduced in 1536 and for centuries was used almost exclusively to feed animals. Barley, oat, and rye among the poor, and wheat for the governing classes, were eaten as bread, porridge, gruel, and pasta by all members of society. Fava beans and vegetables were important supplements to the cereal-based diet of the lower orders. The meat was more expensive and therefore more prestigious, and in the form of the game was common only on the tables of the nobility and poachers. The most prevalent butcher meats were pork, chicken, and other domestic fowl. Beef, which required greater investment in land, was less common. Cod and herring were mainstays among the northern populations, and dried, smoked, or salted made their way far inland. A wide variety of other saltwater and freshwater fish were also eaten. Castles generally had their fish ponds. Slow transportation and inefficient food preservation techniques, drying, salting, smoking, and pickling made long-distance trade of many foods expensive. Because of this, the food of the nobility was more prone to foreign influence than the cuisine of the poor and was dependent on exotic spices and expensive imports. As each level of society imitated the one above it, innovations from international trade and foreign wars from the 12th century onwards gradually disseminated through the upper middle class of medieval cities. Aside from the economic unavailability of luxuries such as spices, decrees outlawed the consumption of certain foods among certain social classes, sumptuary laws limited the conspicuous consumption among the nouveau riche. Social norms also dictated that the food of the working class be less refined, since it was believed there was a natural resemblance between one's labor and one's food, so manual labor required coarser, cheaper food. A type of refined cooking developed in the late Middle Ages that set the standard among the nobility all over Europe. Common seasonings in the highly spiced sweet-sour repertory typical of upper-class medieval food included verjuice, wine, and vinegar in combination with spices such as black pepper, saffron, and ginger. These, along with the widespread use of sugar or honey, gave many dishes a sweet-sour flavor. Almonds were very popular as a thickener in soups, stews, and sauces, particularly as almond milk. The cuisines of the cultures of the Mediterranean basin had since antiquity been based on cereals, particularly various types of wheat. Porridge and gruel, and later bread, became the basic food staple that made up the majority of calorie intake for most of the population. From the 8th to the 11th centuries, the proportion of various bowls of cereal in the diet rose from about 0.3 to 0.75. Dependence on wheat remained significant throughout the medieval era and spread northwards. In colder climates, wheat was usually unaffordable for most people and was associated with the higher classes. The centrality of bread in religious rituals such as the Eucharist meant that it enjoyed especially high prestige among foodstuffs. Only olive oil and wine had a comparable value, but both remained exclusive outside of the warmer wine and olive-growing regions. In the British Isles, northern France, the Low Countries, the northern German-speaking areas, Scandinavia, and the Baltic, the climate was generally too harsh for the cultivation of grapes and olives. In the south, wine was the common drink for both rich and poor alike, though the commoner usually had to settle for cheap second pressing wine, while beer was the commoner's drink in the north and wine was an expensive import. Citrus fruits, though not the most common today, and pomegranates were common in the Mediterranean. Dried figs and dates occurred in the north, but were used rather sparingly in cooking. Olive oil was a ubiquitous ingredient around the Mediterranean but remained an expensive import in the north, where the oil of poppy, walnut, hazel, and filbert was the most affordable alternative. Butter and lard, especially after the terrible mortality during the Black Death, were used in considerable quantities in the northern and northwestern regions. All types of cooking involved the use of open fires. Stoves did not appear until the 18th century, and cooks had to know how to cook directly over an open fire. Ovens were used, but they were expensive to construct and only existed in fairly large households and bakeries. Castles, of course, would have their ovens, often several different ones. Outside of castles, it was common for a community to have shared ownership of an oven to ensure that the bread baking essential to everyone was made communal rather than private. There were also portable ovens designed to be filled with food and then buried in hot coals, and even larger ones on wheels that were used to sell pies in the streets of medieval towns. Almost all cooking was done in simple stewpots, since this was the most efficient use of firewood and did not waste precious cooking juices, making potages and stews the most common dishes. Overall, most evidence suggests that medieval dishes had a fairly high fat content, or at least when fat could be afforded. This was considered less of a problem in a time of backbreaking toil, famine, and a greater acceptance, even desirability, of plumpness. Only the poor or sick, and devout ascetics, were thin. The fruit was readily combined with meat, fish, and eggs. It was considered important to make sure that the dish agreed with contemporary standards of medicine and dietetics. This meant that food had to be tempered according to its nature by an appropriate combination of preparation and mixing certain ingredients, condiments, and spices. Fish was seen as being cold and moist, and best cooked in a way that heated and dried it, such as frying or oven baking, and seasoned with hot and dry spices. Beef was dry and hot and should therefore be boiled. The pork was hot and moist and should therefore always be roasted. In some recipe collections, alternative ingredients were assigned with more consideration to the humoral nature than what a modern cook would consider similar in taste. In a recipe for quince pie, cabbage is said to work equally well, and in another turnips could be replaced by pears. The completely edible short crust pie did not appear in recipes until the 15th century. Before that, the pastry was primarily used as a cooking container in a technique known as huff paste. Recipe collections show that gastronomy in the late Middle Ages developed significantly. New techniques, like the short crust pie and the clarification of jelly with egg whites, began to appear in recipes in the late 14th century, and recipes began to include detailed instructions instead of being mere memory aids to an already skilled cook. The period between 500 and 1300 saw a major change in diet that affected most of Europe. More intense agriculture on an ever-increasing acreage resulted in a shift from animal products, meat, and dairy products to various grains and vegetables as the staple of the majority population. Before the 14th century, bread was not as common among the lower classes, especially in the north where wheat was more difficult to grow. A bread-based diet became gradually more common during the 15th century and replaced warm intermediate meals that were porridge or gruel-based. Leavened bread was more common in wheat-growing regions in the south, while unleavened flatbread of barley, rye, or oats remained more common in northern and highland regions, and unleavened flatbread was also common as provisions for troops. The most common grains were rye, barley, buckwheat, millet, and oats. Rice remained a fairly expensive import for most of the Middle Ages and was grown in northern Italy only towards the end of the period. Wheat was common all over Europe and was considered to be the most nutritious of all grains, but was more prestigious and thus more expensive. The finely sifted white flour that modern Europeans are most familiar with was reserved for the bread of the upper classes. As one descended the social ladder, bread became coarser and darker, and its bran content increased. In times of grain shortages or outright famine, grains could be supplemented with cheaper and less desirable substitutes like chestnuts, dried legumes, acorns, ferns, and a wide variety of more or less nutritious vegetable matter. One of the most common constituents of a medieval meal, either as part of a banquet or as a small snack, were sops, pieces of bread with which a liquid like wine, soup, broth, or sauce could be soaked up and eaten. Another common sight at the medieval dinner table was the frumenty, a thick wheat porridge often boiled in a meat broth and seasoned with spices. Porridges were also made of every type of grain and could be served as desserts or dishes for the sick if boiled in milk or almond milk and sweetened with sugar. Pies filled with meats, eggs, vegetables, or fruit were common throughout Europe, as were turnovers, fritters, donuts, and many similar pastries. By the late Middle Ages, biscuits and especially wafers, eaten for dessert, had become high-prestige foods and came in many varieties. Grain, either as breadcrumbs or flour, was also the most common thickener of soups and stews, alone or in combination with almond milk. The fruit was popular and could be served fresh, dried, or preserved, and was a common ingredient in many cooked dishes. Since sugar and honey were both expensive, it was common to include many types of fruit in dishes that called for sweeteners of some sort. The fruits of choice in the South were lemons, citrons, bitter oranges. The sweet type was not introduced until several hundred years later, pomegranates, quinces, and, of course, grapes. Further north, apples, pears, plums, and strawberries were more common. Figs and dates were eaten all over Europe but remained rather expensive imports in the north. Vegetables such as cabbage, beets, onions, garlic, and carrots were common foodstuffs. Many of these were eaten daily by peasants and workers but were less prestigious than meat. Cookbooks, intended mostly for those who could afford such luxuries, which appeared in the late Middle Ages, only contained a small number of recipes using vegetables as the main ingredient. The lack of recipes for many basic vegetable dishes, such as potages, has been interpreted not to mean that they were absent from the meals of the nobility, but rather that they were considered so basic that they did not require recording. Carrots were available in many variants during the Middle Ages, among them a tastier reddish-purple variety and a less prestigious green-yellow type. Various legumes, like chickpeas, fava beans, and peas were also common and important sources of protein, especially among the lower classes. Except for peas, legumes were often viewed with some suspicion by the dietitians advising the upper class, partly because they tended to cause flatulence but also because they were associated with the coarse food of peasants. Common and often basic ingredients in many modern European cuisines like potatoes, kidney beans, cacao, vanilla, tomatoes, chili peppers, and maize were not available to Europeans until the late 15th century after European contact with the Americas, and even then often took a long time for the new foodstuffs to be accepted by society at large. Although less prestigious than other animal meats, and often seen as merely an alternative to meat on fast days, seafood was the mainstay of many coastal populations. Fish, to the medieval person, was also a general name for anything not considered a proper land-living animal, including marine mammals such as whales and porpoises. Also included were the beaver, due to its scaly tail and considerable time spent in water, and barnacle geese, due to a lack of knowledge of where they migrated. Such foods were also considered appropriate for fast days. Especially important was the fishing and trade of herring and cod in the Atlantic and the Baltic Sea. The herring was of unprecedented significance to the economy of much of northern Europe, and it was one of the most common commodities traded by the Hanseatic League. Kippers made from herring caught in the North Sea could be found in markets as far away as Constantinople. While large quantities of fish were eaten fresh, a large proportion was salted, dried, and, to a lesser extent, smoked. Stockfish, cod that was split down the middle, fixed to a pole, and dried, was very common, though preparation could be time-consuming, and meant beating the dried fish with a mallet before soaking it in water. A wide range of mollusks including oysters, mussels, and scallops was eaten by coastal and river-dwelling populations, and freshwater crayfish were seen as a desirable alternative to meat during fish days. Compared to meat, fish was much more expensive for inland populations, especially in Central Europe, and therefore not an option for most. Freshwater fish such as pike, carp, bream, perch, lamprey, and trout were common. Wild game was popular among those who could obtain it, but most meats came from domesticated animals. The beef was not as common as today because raising cattle was labor-intensive, requiring pastures and feed, and oxen and cows were much more valuable as draft animals and for producing milk. Animals slaughtered because they were no longer able to work were not particularly appetizing and were therefore less valued. Far more common was pork, as pigs required less attention and cheaper feed. Domestic pigs often ran freely even in towns and could be fed on just about any organic kitchen waste, and suckling pigs was a sought-after delicacy. Mutton and lamb were fairly common, especially in areas with a sizable wool industry, as was veal. Every part of the animal was eaten, including ears, snout, tail, tongue, and womb. Intestines, bladder, and stomachs could be used as casings for sausage or even illusion food such as giant eggs. Among the meats that today are rare or even considered inappropriate for human consumption are the hedgehog and porcupine, occasionally mentioned in late medieval recipe collections. A wide range of birds was eaten, including swans, peafowl, quail, partridge, storks, cranes, larks, linnets, and other songbirds that could be trapped in nets, and just about any other wild bird that could be hunted. Swans and peafowl were domesticated to some extent but were only eaten by the social elite, and more praised for their fine appearance as stunning entertainment dishes, and entremet, than for their meat. Geese and ducks had been domesticated but were not as popular as the chicken, the fowl equivalent of the pig. Meats were more expensive than plant foods. Though rich in protein, the calorie-to-weight ratio of meat was less than that of plant food. Meat could be up to 4 times as expensive as bread. Fish was up to 16 times as costly, and was still expensive even for coastal populations. This meant that fasts could mean an especially meager diet for those who could not afford alternatives to meat and animal products like milk and eggs. It was only after the Black Death had eradicated up to half of the European population that meat became more common even for poorer people. The drastic reduction in many populated areas resulted in a labor shortage, meaning that wages shot up. It also left vast areas of farmland untended, making them available for pasture and putting more meat on the market. Milk was an important source of animal protein for those who could not afford meat. It would mostly come from cows, but milk from goats and sheep was also common. Plain fresh milk was not consumed by adults except the poor or sick and was usually reserved for the very young or elderly. Poor adults would sometimes drink buttermilk or whey or milk that was soured or watered down. Fresh milk was overall less common than other dairy products because of the lack of technology to keep it from spoiling. On occasion, it was used in upper-class kitchens in stews, but it was difficult to keep fresh in bulk and almond milk was generally used in its stead. The cheese was far more important as a foodstuff, especially for common people, and it has been suggested that it was, during many periods, the chief supplier of animal protein among the lower classes. Many varieties of cheese eaten today, like Dutch Edam, Northern French Brie, and Italian Parmesan was available and well-known in late medieval times. There were also whey cheeses, like ricotta, made from byproducts of the production of harder cheeses. The cheese was used in cooking pies and soups, the latter being common fare in German-speaking areas. Butter, another important dairy product, was in popular use in the regions of Northern Europe that specialized in cattle production in the latter half of the Middle Ages, the Low Countries, and Southern Scandinavia. While most other regions used oil or lard as cooking fats, butter was the dominant cooking medium in these areas. Its production also allowed for a lucrative butter export from the 12th century onward. The term dessert comes from the old French de servir, to clear a table, literally to unserve, and originated during the Middle Ages. It would typically consist of dragées and mulled wine accompanied by aged cheese, and by the late Middle Ages could also include fresh fruit covered in sugar, honey, or syrup, and boiled down fruit pastes. Sugar, from its first appearance in Europe, was viewed as much as a drug as a sweetener. Its long-lived medieval reputation as an exotic luxury encouraged its appearance in elite contexts accompanying meats and other dishes that to modern taste are more naturally savory. There was a wide variety of fritters, crepes with sugar, sweet custards, and darioles, almond milk, and eggs in a pastry shell that could also include fruit and sometimes even bone marrow or fish. Marzipan in many forms was well known in Italy and southern France by the 1340s and is assumed to be of Arab origin. Anglo-Norman cookbooks are full of recipes for sweet and savory custards, potages, sauces, and tarts with strawberries, cherries, apples, and plums. English chefs also had a penchant for using flower petals such as roses, violets, and elderflowers. An early form of quiche can be found in Fermi of Curry, a 14th century recipe collection, as a tourte de braie with a cheese and egg yolk filling. In northern France, a wide assortment of waffles and wafers was eaten with cheese and hypocras or a sweet malmsey as issued a table. The ever-present candied ginger, coriander, aniseed, and other spices were referred to as epices de chambre and were taken as digestible at the end of a meal to close the stomach. Like their Muslim counterparts in Spain, the Arab conquerors of Sicily introduced a wide variety of new sweets and desserts that eventually found their way to the rest of Europe. Just like Montpellier, Sicily was once famous for its comfits, nougat candy, and almond clusters. From the south, the Arabs also brought the art of ice cream making that produced sorbet and several examples of sweet cakes and pastries, cassata alla siciliana, made from marzipan, sponge cake and sweetened ricotta and cannoli alla siciliana, originally capelli di turkey, fried, chilled pastry tubes with a sweet cheese filling. Like their Muslim counterparts in Spain, the Arab conquerors of Sicily introduced a wide variety of new sweets and desserts that eventually found their way to the rest of Europe. Just like Montpellier, Sicily was once famous for its comfits, nougat candy, and almond clusters. From the south, The Arabs also brought the art of ice cream making that produced sorbet and several examples of sweet cakes and pastries, cassata alla siciliana, made from marzipan, sponge cake and sweetened ricotta and cannoli alla siciliana, originally capelli di turkey, fried, chilled pastry tubes with a sweet cheese filling. Spices were among the most luxurious products available in the Middle Ages, the most common being black pepper, cinnamon, cumin, nutmeg, ginger, and cloves. They all had to be imported from plantations in Asia and Africa, which made them extremely expensive and gave them social cachet such that pepper, for example, was hoarded, traded, and conspicuously donated in the manner of gold bullion. It has been estimated that around 1,000 tons of pepper and 1,000 tons of other common spices were imported into Western Europe each year during the late Middle Ages. The value of these goods was the equivalent of a yearly supply of grain for 1.5 million people. While pepper was the most common spice, the most exclusive, though not the most obscure in its origin, was saffron, used as much for its vivid yellow-red color as for its flavor, for according to the humor, yellow signified hot and dry, valued qualities. Turmeric provided a yellow substitute, and touches of gilding at banquets supplied both the medieval love of the ostentatious show and Galenic dietary lore. At the sumptuous banquet that Cardinal Riario offered the daughter of the King of Naples in June 1473, the bread was gilded. Among the spices that have now fallen into obscurity are grains of paradise, a relative of cardamom which almost entirely replaced pepper in late medieval North French cooking, long pepper, mace, spikenard, galangal, and cubeb. Sugar, unlike today, was considered to be a type of spice due to its high cost and humoral qualities. Few dishes employed just one type of spice or herb, but rather a combination of several different ones. Even when a dish was dominated by a single flavor, it was usually combined with another to produce a compound taste, for example, parsley and cloves or pepper and ginger. Common herbs such as sage, mustard, and parsley were grown and used in cooking all over Europe, as were caraway, mint, dill, and fennel. Many of these plants grew throughout all of Europe or were cultivated in gardens, and were a cheaper alternative to exotic spices. Mustard was particularly popular with meat products and was described by Hildegard of Bingen as a poor man's food. While locally grown herbs were less prestigious than spices, they were still used in upper-class food, but were then usually less prominent or included merely as coloring. Anise was used to flavor fish and chicken dishes, and its seeds were served as sugar-coated comfits. Surviving medieval recipes frequently call for flavoring with several sour, tart liquids. Wine, verjuice vinegar, and the juices of various fruits, especially one those with tart flavors, were almost universal and a hallmark of late medieval cooking. In combination with sweeteners and spices, it produced a distinctive, pungent, fruity flavor. Equally common, and used to complement the tanginess of these ingredients, were almonds. They were used in a variety of ways: whole, shelled or unshelled, slivered, ground, and, most importantly, processed into almond milk. This last type of non-dairy milk product is probably the single most common ingredient in late medieval cooking and blended the aroma of spices and sour liquids with a mild taste and creamy texture. Salt was ubiquitous and indispensable in medieval cooking. Salting and drying was the most common form of food preservation and meant that especially fish and meat were often heavily salted. Many medieval recipes specifically warn against oversalting, and there were recommendations for soaking certain products in water to get rid of excess salt. Salt was present during more elaborate or expensive meals. The richer the host, and the more prestigious the guest, the more elaborate would be the container in which it was served and the quality and price of the salt. Wealthy guests were provided with salt cellars made of pewter, precious metals, or other fine materials, often intricately decorated. The rank of a diner also decided how finely ground and white the salt was. Salt for cooking, preservation, or use by common people was coarser. Sea salt, or bay salt, in particular, had more impurities and was described in colors ranging from black to green. Expensive salt, on the other hand, looked like the standard commercial salt common today. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe for more videos.